Well, good morning, everyone.
Man, first of all, giving all glory to God, I can't believe I'm here. As I was listening to the testimony and especially the video presentation, sitting in the seats, my mind began to travel in a good place, down memory lane. It was at this church, Gloria and I, after securing my master's degree at Syracuse University, we had a missionary that was attending First Baptist Church up there in Camillus. I believe it was, what was the name of that church again? Been so long. Camillus Baptist Church. West Genesee Hills, there it is. How many of you guys know when you get past 5-0, you have those memory lapses? Get a little gray hair and add another 15 pounds on. It comes with the territory, right? West Genesee Hills Baptist Church, we supported a missionary name. I don't know if you know this name, Sarah Wood. She was a missionary that First Baptist was supporting, and she was visiting at that church in West Genesee Hills, and we're in the process of relocating. And hey, I said, hey, we need to find a Bible preaching, Bible teaching, when fundamental was a good thing to say, kind of a church. And she said, hey, I noticed you got three little boys and you're looking for a church. I have the right one. First Baptist Church to West Hollywood. And we moved down here in 95. And we began to participate in this church. My boys, right now they are 28, 27, and 26. But my boys were baptized up there. And the memory of being dean and working at Hollywood Christian School and performing with some of you with the Christmas play and being a part, that I never let go of that. That will always be part of my spiritual DNA, that I have roots here and I'm glad to be home today. Glad to be home. Now, as I look at the balcony, I'm in this assembly in this beautiful edifice, it reminds me, because I didn't check with the pastor about my time limit, but you know, in the book of Acts, Paul was preaching long and some young man fell out the balcony. We got a balcony. But I promise you I won't be that long, okay? But I just ask that if you would just give God your undivided attention. Don't get preoccupied with the presenter. Give God, would you please do me the blessing to make yourself available to have an encounter with God today? I am so proud of all of you to overcome the elements, that cold rain and that temperature and a good cup of soup and a book. Hey, you can park there on the sheets, right? But you demonstrated power, and you made a power move, and you are here to worship the Most High God. Amen? Amen? So for our time together, I'd like to turn your attention to our text. I'm going to read the text, then I'm going to open up in prayer. I'll do a little introduction, and today's Bible study, righteous and redirected regulations. Now, I know when you hear that term, regulations and rules, right away we cringe. Right away, we have a natural disposition that when there's a rule, what do we want to do? We want to what? Break it. Case in point. If you're painting and put a sign saying, wet paint, do not touch, guess what people do? They'll touch it. Or if you put a sign, don't walk on the lawn or the grass, what do people do? They walk on the grass. Well, I want to talk about some righteous, some redefined regulations that are inseparable from our relationship with Jesus Christ. There'll be some interchangeable terms, like law. When I mentioned law, it'll be regulation or rule. So those are some of the terminology I'll be implementing this morning, but I'm glad you're here. So if you have your text, let the pastor know by saying amen. Amen. All right, that means everybody on the same page. Now, I'm reading from my preference. And again, people fight over things they have no business fighting over. I know that. What translation do you read? Well, I carry this book, so that means I'm holier than you. No. It's just my preference, and I have a personal preference for the KJV. So I'm reading out the KJV, Romans chapter 8, verses 1 through 10. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus had made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, God, sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritual minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So then they that are in the flesh cannot please God. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. And if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. Let's pray. Father, we will now make ourselves available. I ask that you create in us the capacity. We know we have it through the Spirit of God, but God, our minds can wander. It's hard to stay focused with your divine hand. Put us in a place to receive your word. And by receiving your word, help this piece of clay communicate it in such a way that they'll be able to make some application that will change conduct and change behavior and demonstrate the image of Jesus Christ. That's our hope. That's our prayer. That's what I'm believing. In Jesus' name, for his glory alone, amen. Amen. Okay. Now, Paul in chapter 8 speaks about a brand new dynamic that each and every one of us enjoy. Something that you could not cultivate with intellectual pursuits. Something that was not a, cannot be a reality without divine intervention. You see, Paul will now describe the ministry of the supernatural in your life, aka Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, because prior to the Spirit of God leading you, you and I, we walked the steps of death. Our decisions, the direction, our goals, our pursuit was all centered by, as James describes them, passions and lusts. That's where war comes from. Conflict comes from. Some of us were dictated, and if I'm speaking to you this morning, I'm just, again, I speak in love, not judgment and condemnation. Some of you are here as Pastor and I was processing this message. You know, we can park in the past and celebrate the past, but we're not parking. We got to move forward. And we got to make a difference in the community around us. And that means you must be led and governed and empowered by a dynamic that will change this community. You see, you can provide resources, but if you don't have the power and the catalyst to get it done, it ain't getting done. It must be something greater than your instinct, greater than your emotions. Again, we've been driven by passions, driven by fear, doubt, anger, loneliness, depression, all these disquieting things should have no power in your life. Y'all don't mind me preaching this morning, do you? The greatest power in the universe is the Spirit of God. It's the Spirit of God that'll move that girl from the abortion line. It's the Spirit of God that'll place us and lead us into great decision making. It's the Spirit of God that will move a person that even when they're in the deepest place of apathy, the Spirit of God will say, don't take your life. But we are sophisticated today. We know the nuances of science and technology, but I've never seen a computer change anybody's life. But the power of God. And Paul's going to talk about the divine source and ministry and the sanctification, that sanctifying. Oh, by the way, before I continue, if you want to live victorious, raise your hand. If not, we're going to lay hands on you. But if you want to live victoriously and you want to secure the steps of success professionally, relationally, it's the indwelling presence of the Spirit of God that secures that victory. Notice I said victory, not victimization. You need to move away from victimization. You need to move away from your self-pity, parking there. Because did you know the other side of self-pity, closely related to that, is that word that rhymes with ride and starts with a P called pride. Because I'm always taken. I'm always need something. That's the self-pity person. Then we have the arrogant and condescending part of pride. Pride should not rule our lives. The Spirit of God should. And Paul's going to speak about that. See, if you're still under pride, you're still under old rules. You're under old regulations. You're under the flesh. Turn your attention to verse 1 with me now. Romans 8, verse 1. Paul makes a statement. It's imperative. Therefore, there is therefore now no condemnation for those that are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after flesh, but after the Spirit. No more penalty, no more judgment, no condemnation, but commendation. No, yes, no condemnation, but we are now commended. Commendation, what does that word mean, Pastor? See, one, condemnation parks me and sets me up for punishment and judgment for sin. Are you grateful for Calvary that you don't line up for that anymore? So there's no more. So why are you judging yourself? We got any people like to beat themselves up all the time? Condemn yourself? Don't know who you are. But God has commended us. In other words, found you praiseworthy. When someone's being commended, that individual, by an authority, is blessing them, is bringing them a position to a praiseworthy position, a position of, catch this, approval and acceptance. Approval and acceptance. So you don't have to get on Facebook and examine how many likes you got. I was approved by God before Facebook even showed up. And some of you are looking for acceptance and approval from the wrong places, and they can't deliver. They're like a bad check that's always bouncing. My approval, and I know I'm not being desensitive, and I understand that maybe your upbringing and maybe your life experience and the conditions in your home weren't that great, where someone just beat on you and beat on you and beat on you physically and emotionally, and you could never measure up. And some of you are 30, 40, 50, whatever years old, still trying to measure up, still looking for acceptance. Let me tell you, the Bible tells us in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 6, that we have been accepted in the beloved. I don't know about you, but I kind of walk a little tall when I know God's accepted me. But many of you walk like this because you're under old regulations and old rules that govern your life. No more acceptance is absolutely in Jesus Christ. Once we trust that Jesus Christ is our Lord and personal Savior, we begin a brand new relationship. I didn't say religion, but a relationship. But I want you to tell you, this personal relationship with Christ the Lord is inseparable from regulations or his ruling influence. Again, a relationship with Jesus Christ is inseparable from his, now I didn't say man's religion, his regulations and his ruling influence. And his ruling influence is the Spirit of God. I understand the cliche, we want relationship before rules. But I tell you what, with Jesus Christ, they both come together. You can't have one without the other. And we have created there is a representation of evangelicalism that doesn't want responsibility and doesn't want accountability. But you at Hollywood Community Church, as we look toward the future, you will separate yourself and be the light in this community, and you'll be known because of your relationship with God. How do you know that they're in a relationship with God, Pastor, at this church? Because they love God and they keep his commandments. And one of his commandments, he said, go and what? Make disciples. I'm gonna speak to this a little bit later. That's the pastor's job. That's the deacon's job. I don't have the gift of evangelism. Well, that great commission, which is so often, as you know, the great omission, it's not like, for instance, if I drive on Taft, and I violate the regulation and the rule at a stop sign or a light, and the officer, one of the nation's finest in the community, pulls me over, am I going to say to him, well, I don't have the gift to keep that rule? That's ludicrous, right? So why do we adopt that stance when it comes down to you opening your mouth and giving your testimony? And as Pastor said, finding the creative things, because you have creativity in you from the God of the universe. So if you submit yourself to the Spirit of God, we're going to get to that a little bit later, but if you submit to the Spirit of God and regulate it by the Spirit of God, instead of fear that keeps your mouth closed, you'll be walking in the love of God to give the gospel, to give the good news. Amen? But again, it comes down to what rules you follow and what regulations that you find yourself under. You see, let me give you an operating definition of the word regulations, because I said again, a relationship with Jesus Christ is inseparable from his regulations and his ruling influence. Regulations, check this out, regulations. It is a law or rule or other ordered prescribed by authority. A law or rule ordered and prescribed by authority, especially to regulate conduct. How many of you guys know God is a God of order? People say to me, Pastor, see, that's why I left the church, Pastor, because I don't like organized religion. Let me ask you a question. You're organizing your job. Is there order to the college and the school that you attend? There are things in place for what? Order, or you got what? Chaos. And we know that God is not the author of confusion, but in peace in all the churches of the saints. So there is a place for rules and regulations. Amen? For application, the latter part of Romans 1:6 says, I know in some translations they don't have who walk not after the flesh, but after the spirit. But we know that Paul is emphasizing it in verse 4. So somehow it got in the text where they was consistently in alignment with verse 4, who walk not after the flesh, but after the spirit. Now, just for homework, real quickly, by way of review, we know the difference between the works of the flesh and the works of the spirit. Paul writes that in Galatians chapter 5. Now we know the fruits and manifestation of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, meekness, gentleness, self-control. Do you want that in your house? And when I'm counseling a couple, or if I see a prospective couple that maybe they were marching down the road of matrimony, or they become an item, and I sit down with them, I say, look, what kind of fruit is in this relationship? If you tell me the fruit that's in a relationship, I'll tell you if the relationship came from God or not. Did you hear me? If it's in your relationship, is there self-control so I don't have to worry about your purity? In your relationship, is there love, peace, joy? Does it reflect Christ, or does it reflect the works of the flesh that we know the debased nature of our human nature? Lust, pride, lying, arrogancy, pride, controlling. All. If that's in this relationship, God didn't plant that relationship. You are creating that relationship. Now, that's another sermon. Let me get back to my text. When we walk not after the flesh, but after the spirit, in other words, we no longer adhere to and subject ourselves to the old regulations of the flesh. We don't submit. We have been redirected by righteous regulations and righteous rules as opposed to the unrighteousness that we find in the flesh, in our humanity. That's why we need Jesus. We have new regulations from a righteous ruler, not some rigid religionist or a Pharisee. We have a righteous ruler in Christ, not a religionist that's very rigid for the purpose of control. See, when it's the Spirit of God and His rules and regulations, they are consistent with the Master. But when it's rigid religiosity, it is consistent with the rules of man. Everybody say man. Man-centered. I want to control. You wear these type of clothes. You talk like us. You walk like us. Or we won't let you be a part of us. Anybody hear what I'm saying? And some of us was introduced to that. And you always had to measure up and walk in line and keep pace. Busy keeping the rules versus keeping your relationship with God. Why? Because you didn't know that there's no more condemnation in Christ Jesus. So no matter what this group has said about me or what they think about me, God says, no more condemnation. You need to look in the mirror, and when you're beating yourself up, you challenge those thoughts. You challenge your disposition with what the Word of God has said. I'm no longer condemned. Look in that mirror and say, I'm no longer condemned. I am God's favorite. I'm a child of God. And He loves me deeply. This is critical. Because the source of the rules, or the source or the origin of the regulations, would dictate its efficacy. In other words, how effective is the rule able to change your conduct, to change your behavior? Couples, the conduct that will keep a rich and deep marital relationship, you need to examine the source of the rules that's in your house, that's in your marriage, how you interact with your kids, even how you conduct yourself in church. Because if the Spirit is ruling a house, show me a happy home. A happy home is where the Holy Spirit is ruling and welcome. I've heard people say, if mama ain't happy. Oh, y'all, you know that rule too, huh? I hear what you're saying, but you see, mama's like she is because of the leadership in her life. The thermostat of the home should be the Spirit of God, not the man or not the woman. It regulates the temperature. What do thermostats do? They regulate the temperature in your home, right? Make sure that the regulator is the Spirit of God and His Word. You need some more heat? Make sure the Holy Ghost is leading you to say that. You need to be more cool, chill out. Make sure the Spirit leads you there, but don't get too cold because you'll be a corpse. It's important to me to be effective change in my life. Keeping, memorizing scripture is essential. Hiding it in your heart, that's essential. Reading the Bible, that's essential. But if you don't have the Spirit of God, you just get more religion. I know a lot of religious people. I know a lot of people that can exegete scripture, know Greek, Hebrew, enunciate, articulate what God has said, but their life got no power. You see, when my boys were, I had a conversation with my three sons, BJ, Philip, and Seth. Had a heavy conversation. You know, when you're a parent, you got to have those heavy conversations. You got to have those tough conversations. And my concern was that I didn't want them to be religious. What do you mean, Pastor? I've been in all kinds of Christian schools. You don't mind me being real for a second, do you? I've been in all type of Christian schools. I've been in all different church settings, and I watched all kinds of kids and all kinds of people grow up in church. I've been in church all my life. Been in church all my life. No church, no the Bible. Old Testament survey, New Testament survey, know the scriptures, been in plays, I've been participating, an active member of a church or a religious organization. And when they get to college, they want nothing to do with God now. Or they don't have to go to college. Now they reach a season of life where they think they're not under mom and dad's authority and they understand, so they go and do their own thing. And I said, sons, you've been in Christian school all your life. Our boys have been, and there was 1 year where we took a break where they were just homeschooled. But they started right here at First Baptist of West Hollywood, the ministry, Hollywood Christian Schools. My boys got their foundation solidified and encouraged. And at one point, you guys partnered alongside me and Gloria and helped raise my boys today. But there was a season, the preteens years, and 13, you ever hear the 13, 14-year-old think they're grown, you know, anything like that? They don't know nothing about paying bills. They don't know nothing about life, but they think they know everything. I'm telling you, brother, you can't Google everything and know life, all right? But the problem, I said, I love the fact Gloria and I are grateful and thankful for your testimony and your witness. I understand the pressure. I understand the pressure of having to being a PK, a pastor's kid. I understand that we've made some tough decisions about you not connecting and collecting bad information. I call it connecting and collecting. Connecting and collecting bad information from people that may not be on the same page spiritually. But promise me this, son. You need to get beyond rules or regulations or scripture in your relationship with God. I need to see His power and His presence in your life. And how do I know when His power and His presence is in your life? Because you're going to want to love God, not be forced to love God. And you're going to get to a place that when temptation knocks on the door, and it will, you're going to say, God, be merciful to me. I need you right now. And you'll be making a power move because of the Spirit of God and saying no. It's so important. Again, the rules and the regulations, they come from God. They are divine. His divine power has given us everything we need to know for life. That's very important. Verse 2. Oh, boy, my time. How am I doing for time? It's already left. Uh-oh. How am I doing with time, Pastor? That's what I thought. See, that's why. See, we pass this in time. You kind of feel it. Okay, time check. Because you pastors, you're a pastor. I keep here to 4 o'clock, but we're not going to do that. So let me expedite this. Let's move on. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus had made me free from the law of sin and death. In other words, translation of application for purposes of application, the new regulations have released me, has released you from the old regulations of the unregenerate man. The unregenerate man, his what ruled him was sin, and it led to death, which is separation from God. Verse 3, we see that the weakness, how impoverished the law couldn't, how it's impotency, the impotency of the law in verses 3 and 4. For what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, God sent his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh. And for sin, what did he do with it? How did he address it? He judged the sin with his own body on Calvary's cross. It wasn't rules, a man. Action. God commended his love toward us that while we were sinners, Christ died for us. And because of his righteous act, we enjoy verse 4. The righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the spirit. He reemphasizes that. You see, the law only said, you're bad, you're wrong, you can't measure up, you fall short. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So no matter how often you memorize and practice, the law can't save you. The law can't rescue you. The law can't put you in a rightful and healthy relationship. The rules can't keep you in a relationship or develop a biblical relationship with God. Because everything that the law demanded, everything that a holy God requires, he gave a propitiation. He gave a righteous, transcending payment for your junk and my junk. That's why he can say, no more condemnation, because Jesus was judged on the cross. Paul, you know, in chapter 7, he talked about the struggle. Everybody say struggle. Struggle. You're born again, you know what struggle is. There's something in you that want to do what God's called you to do, and you have a hard time doing it. Am I the only one? And then there's something in you that loves God 100 miles an hour and loves to follow God. Paul said, what I shouldn't be doing, I find myself doing, but the things that I should do, I find it very hard to do. I understand in Romans chapter 7, I'm paraphrasing, that it's the flesh in me, because in me dwelleth no good thing. In his humanity, but hold the phone, hold up. You're not just human, because if any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. And there is a power in me called the Spirit of God. His resurrecting power can help me do the right thing. Because the law couldn't do that. But the Spirit lives in me. So I want to give you a tip. Leave chapter 7, go to chapter 8. Stop running back to chapter 7 to make excuses. Stop going, but I'm the only human. This is too hard for me. Pastor, you don't know how I was raised. Pastor, you know the conditions. God, here's the big one. Here's the big one. You ready? Here's the big one. God knows my heart. Yeah, he know your heart is wicked and desperately sick. That's what he knows. And you need a doctor. You need King Jesus to come in and change your heart. Oh, God, thank you for giving me a heart transplant. Amen. Praise the Lord. I know y'all connecting. Amen. Pastor, I'm having too much fun up here. Real quickly, verse 5 and 6. I want to 5 through 8. Let me move on. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they are after the spirit the things of the spirit. For to be carnal minded is death, but to be spiritual minded is life and peace. For the carnal mind is that enmity against God, for it cannot be subject to the law of God, neither can it indeed be. So that they are in the flesh cannot please God. Real quickly, real simple, real simple. In this passage, I want you to consider FM and AM. FM and AM. As you sit in your vehicle and you have a radio and you dial in the format, FM or AM,
typically AM is talk radio and news and some country and different things, and that's a different genre on your FM dial. So you have your AM dial and your FM dial. Everybody with me? When you're under new regulations of God, AM stands for the anointed mentality. The anointed mentality, that is the Spirit of God is ruling that mind, that kind of thinking. So stinking thinking don't show up as much. So that's the AM mindset, AM mentality. FM, fleshly mentality. Fleshly mentality. I'm dirty, I never change, nobody loves me. And, you know, I just hate, I just lie, I just cheat, I manipulate, I defend myself, I'm prideful. That fleshly mindset, each and every day when you wake up in the morning, you got to tune in, brothers and sisters. Either you're going to be AM or FM. How do you know AM and FM is going on in somebody's home? Wife comes on, just looks over, and looks at the husband. Good morning, love. What's so good about it? I didn't get what I want last night. I don't like where I am. Boy, you know when the people are FM. Negative, negative, angry, angry, condemning, biting, contentious, fleshly mindset. It's very obvious. You don't believe me? Drive on the Florida Turnpike or drive on 95. Stand in line at Publix, and you see, it don't matter what age you are, they'll run up your toes. And then move in. And you think you got that parking spot, all of a sudden another car pulls in. Fleshly mindset. But anointed mindset says, I'm a conqueror through Jesus Christ. I'm ready to face any challenge because of the power that God's over me. With this anointed mindset, it redirects me to God's word and his rule and that power in the word of God. And that's what you have to engage in the Christian life to make a difference in this community. Make sure you're AM and not FM. Everybody got it? Because when you are FM with a fleshly mentality, you cannot do the purposes of God. You cannot please God. You won't measure to his expectations. But when I have an anointed mindset, because guess what? It wasn't Russell Crowe in Beautiful Mind. We got the beautiful mind. We got the beautiful mind because of the Bible tells us in Corinthians that we have the mind of Christ. Let's process that some more. Yeah, I know it's intimidating to raise kids today and teenagers, and I understand the job market and the pressure and the global challenges and what's happening internationally, and that we've had a new election and how the country's all divided. You don't walk in FM, you dial in on AM. Because what's beautiful about it, I can't tune in for Gloria, and Gloria can't tune in for me. It's an individual choice. And to change this culture, you as an individual, what are you going to do? It starts with getting back into the mind of Christ, being directed by righteous regulations, and being ruled by the Spirit of God versus the passions of man. Amen? Now, just a closing thought before I invite the pastor up. The ruling influence, Paul said, Christ in you. Christ is not in you if you've not had what I call a spiritual conversion, or I like to explain it this way. There's been a spiritual conception. A spiritual conception based off of John chapter 3. Remember, Jesus met with a man embedded in his religion, in his Judaism, since he was a little boy, being circumcised, being a Pharisee, enjoying the power of and sitting on a rabbinical training. This Pharisee, this Jewish man, followed the Mosaic laws and the rules, and he thought that because he belonged to a specific people group, he thought that because he could keep the law and the Torah, that he had a right relationship with God. But he had enough religion more than anybody in this room, but he was missing something. He was missing what I call a spiritual conception. And that's why Jesus said to him, "Truly, truly, I say unto you, except a man be born again, he cannot enter to the kingdom of God." In other words, you think about a child, you that have children, you that are parents. The spouses got together, so it had to be the right conditions, the right conditions, the right setting, and the right environment for conception to take place. Everybody with me? So that in order for a new life that's never existed before, and it's not just a bag of pieces of flesh or molecules, it is a living baby. I don't know you want to sophisticate and call it fetus. I call them babies. But anyway, it was a special setting and situation where the conditions and the environment and the setting was perfect, and it produced a life. Correct? Spiritually speaking. Likewise, Jesus employed a natural reality to reflect the supernatural life, to reflect what it is to be a follower of Jesus Christ, what it is to be born again. What did Jesus do? He took natural childbirth, and what basically Jesus was saying, if the conditions are right in the mind of a person, not your self-independence, not your self-autonomy, not your pride, not your tradition, I need the right environment, and it's called humility. Show me a soul, man or woman, teenager or adult or young adult, if they have, by the grace of God, the capacity to have that right environment of humility and trust or faith in the Word of God, guess what can happen? The Spirit, pneuma, the presence, the power of God can come into that person and make them brand new. Isn't that what we're supposed to be doing? So when you're witnessing, you need to understand that you're waiting for a childbirth. But it's not physical, it is supernatural. And the daddy, as always, is God. Where are you today? I'm going to invite the pastor to close us out. I'm sure a worship team is going to come up. But I just especially pray that you've had a spiritual conception. Not Baptist, not Catholic, not Episcopalian, not religious training. But there was the environment in your heart and mind where you recognized you were a sinner and you owe a payment for sin, and you know that Jesus Christ paid the penalty for your sin. It takes some humility to acknowledge that. Because when you get out of the way, God comes in. Amen?